Welcome, students. In the previous classes and all, we have studied calculating the space and time complexity for the non-recursive algorithms. That is, for iterative algorithms, we have worked it out. Right? Now, in today's class, we will try to understand how we can calculate the space and time complexity for recursive algorithms. We know that recursive algorithms are the procedures which will be called by themselves. The algorithms will have a procedure call to itself. Okay. In previous examples, while writing the algorithms for certain examples, we have studied something called as depth of the algorithm. Do you remember, students? Can anyone recall? Fine, no worries. We will discuss it once again in today's exercises. Okay, now the recursive algorithms will have two features. When I say two features, means we can say two different cases. Case one and another could be a case two, right? The recursive algorithms we need to write such a way that the recursive call should be stopped at a particular situation or a particular phase. It shouldn't happen that the procedure or the algorithm will go into a recursive mode for an infinite time. If it goes, then definitely we may not get any result out of that particular algorithm. So at a particular phase, at a particular scenario, we have to stop the algorithm to go into the recursive nature. Based upon that, we can have two cases. The first case is that when the algorithm is recursive algorithm, to be more precise, recursive algorithm terminates, and the second one, the recursive algorithm continues. The recursive algorithm continues. The recursive algorithm, as I said, it can have two different cases. At a particular condition or a situation, the algorithm may stop going into the recursive nature, or it may continues to go into a recursive nature. Okay. All the recursive algorithms should exhibit these two cases. Depending upon these two cases, we can calculate the space complexity as well as time complexity. Without that, we cannot perform. For example, do you remember in the factorial of a program, what was the condition we write in order to stop the recursiveness? Can anyone recall? We write certain conditions. At that particular condition, if the condition becomes true, the factorial program will stop going into a recursiveness. Turn out the algorithm. Can someone let me know? Students, are you having your fair book with you?
Yes, sir.
So, is it difficult for you to turn onto the previous pages?
No, sir.
Then why can't you answer for my question? You have written an algorithm for factorial of a program, right? Can you tell me what was the case one in that algorithm? And what was the case two in that algorithm?
Algorithm for a main.
Okay. Algorithm for a main. No, not that one. Do you find algorithm factorial for the recursive one? See, students, I need acknowledgement. Without that, I cannot continue.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
We have written the factorial algorithm for a recursiveness, right? wherein you get two different algorithms. One is the main algorithm and one is recursive algorithm, that is algorithm factorial, which takes a parameter n. Did you find that?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
In that particular algorithm, yes, that is algorithm factorial, can you identify these two cases? At which particular phase the algorithm terminates and what which particular phase the algorithm continues to be a recursive in nature?
So algorithm terminates when n is less than zero. If n is less than zero.
If n is less than zero.
So the algorithm terminates.
That is for the main algorithm. Look into the statements of algorithm factorial. The procedure algorithm, that is factorial, we have written something like this: algorithm factorial, and it takes n as the parameter. Then it has its own body, its statements. Did you find it?
Yes, sir.
If n equals to 0.
If n equals to 1. Different cases, isn't it? When n is equals to 0.
Or n is equals to 1.
What happens? Does the algorithm go into recursive or it will terminate there?
So it will terminate.
It terminates. What about the other case? For which values of n the algorithm goes into a recursive?
Return n into factorial n minus 1.
N is greater than 1, isn't it? If n is greater than 1, what happens there? The algorithm goes into recursive. Identifying, are you able to identify it?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
right?
Sir.
Do we have any other algorithm written in a recursive apart from factorial?
Yes, sir.
Fibonacci, I think we have written an algorithm for that, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Now, in that, for the Fibonacci, can you tell me what is at which particular phase the algorithm terminates? What is the case?
M equals to zero.
Zero. And M equals to 1.
And N equals to 1. N or M, you can take any values. When N is equals to 0 or N equals to 1, it exhibits the case 1 scenario. And what about case 2 scenarios? When N is again greater than 1. Now, what about the other recursive programs, algorithms? I think I had given one more algorithm, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
What is that algorithm name?
Linear search of an element.
So in the linear search, what is the case 1?
N is equal to 0.
N is equals to 0. And case 2? N greater than 0. Correct. Now, if you observe all these scenarios, these three examples, this is case 1 and this one is case 2. Now, case 1 in this explanation means that the recursive algorithm will no longer be recursive. It will just halt there itself. It terminates there itself. Case 2 indicates that these are the values of the instance characteristics or the n values for which the recursive algorithm continue to be a recursive. It will continue to be a recursive. For example, factorial, right? If in the factorial case, when n is 3, it will again, once again, it will call with n as 2. And when n is 2, it again calls n as 1. But when it reaches 1, it stops. It will not call the same algorithm. It stops at particular instance. Like that for the Fibonacci also, we can have two different cases. For one case, the case one where the recursive algorithm will stop or it will exhibit its recursiveness, but whereas in the case two, it will continue to be a recursive nature. Based upon these characteristics, we can calculate the space complexity and time complexity of all the recursive algorithms. Understood the basics here? Now, when I solve these particular problems, now onwards for the recursive algorithms, case one means these are the values of the instance characteristics where the algorithm terminates. Case two means these are the values of the instance characteristics for which the algorithm continues to be a recursive algorithm. Okay, now let us take the example of the first one, that is factorial of a number. Okay, as we just discussed, for all the values, when the n value is 0 or n value is 1, when n value is 0 or n value is 1, then the factorial is going to be what?
Terminating.
It terminating, isn't it? The factorial is going to be terminating. What about the other case? When the n is greater than, if n is greater than 1, then it continues to be a recursive algorithm. So we can have two different cases here for these values. Now, according to that, see, this is the factorial. Let me write it complete word here. Factorial. The algorithm factorial. If n is 0 or if n is 1, then we are returning value 1. Otherwise, we continue to call the recursive algorithm, okay, by subtracting a value from that. So we just decrement the value by n minus 1. Then again, once again, we call and we keep on updating or multiplying that result with the n value. Okay. In this particular factorial, we have studied something called as depth of the algorithm. Can anyone recall it? We have studied something called as depth of the algorithm. Anyone? What are the three different spaces, the space complexity? What are the three different sections we have studied as part of space complexity?
Operation count, step count, and asymptotic notation.
Is that a space or is that a time complexity? That is time complexity. That is time complexity. What are the different aspects of space complexity?
Data space, stack space, and instruction space.
Yes. First one is instruction space. Second one is data space. Third is stack space. Right? When I was explaining you the stack space, I had given you an explanation about what the depth of the algorithm or depth of recursive algorithm. Let me check your memory. How many of you remember? Nobody?
Number of times recursive called.
Number of times the recursive function calls. Whenever we have a recursive function, the factorial, how many times that particular factorial function calls itself? How many times that particular function or the procedure is being called? That we call it to be a depth of the recursion. Okay. Now, to give you just a simple explanation once again, suppose if n is equals to 5, okay, if n is equals to 5, then how many times this factorial function will be called? How many times the factorial function will be called when value of n is 5?
5.
Called for 5 times. That means the depth of this particular factorial algorithm is 5. Depending upon this particular value of or the depth, we can calculate either the time complexity or the space complexity. Okay, let us try to understand how we can calculate the frequencies and the total steps. Now, as a procedure, what we do, we write a total number of frequencies under the frequency column and the total number of steps under the total steps column. Okay. Now, here, since these are the recursive algorithms, it exhibits a special characteristics, that is case 1 and case 2. So what we will do is that we will make again subsections for the frequencies as well as total steps. So for the frequencies, let me write it as a case 1 and then case 2. In the same way, the total number of steps also, we will have two different segments, case 1 and then case 2. Okay. Now here case 1 means when the instance values, pay attention students, the case 1 means what? The instance variables or instance characteristics, that is n value, if it is either 0 or if it is either 1. Okay. In that case, how the algorithm exhibits or how the algorithm executes? What are the statements which will be executing whenever the n value is 0 or n value is 1, which are part of case 1? Okay. Now assume that n value is 0. In that case, is this statement gets executed? If n equals to 0 or n equals to 1, then what do you think, this statement gets executed or not when case is 1?
Yes, sir.
It gets executed. Now, is it an independent statement or it depends upon the instance characteristics? Does it repeat or it's an independent step? It is independent step. This particular condition will be executed only once because it is a simple if statement. It is not a for loops or a while loop, right? Since this condition is executed as part of case 1, what do you expect? The result of this if condition, is it true or false?
True.
It is true. True means it will enter into the its true block, then return 1 will be executed. That means this particular statement also gets executed and the frequency is what? 1. When this return 1 is executed, do you think that this return n into factorial n minus 1 gets executed or not?
No, sir.
Not getting executed. So this is 0. So hardly we have here 4 statements, right? In that else we can take it out. This is a else we can take it out. We can only consider the if condition. Now we are talking about the case 1. Case 1 means the instance characteristics value, that is if either it is 0 or either it is 1. In both these cases, what happens? Obviously this condition gets executed. Okay, since the condition becomes true, it executes the return statement. So it will get executed only one time. And the else block is not at all going to execute, right? Because the if condition is true. So now here, according to this one, the case 1, what will be the total step count here for case 1? It is going to be big O of 1. And here, it is going to be again big O of 1, and this is 0, right? We can exclude this. We can just write a dash here. Now, is it understood, students?
Yes, sir. Sir, actually, Mansi is having some problem to join the meeting. So she tried twice. She's still waiting in the lobby. She's really worried.
No, I don't see her in the lobby here. Nobody is there in the lobby.
Okay,
I can
sir.
See presenter 1 and all attendees as 100. There is nobody in the lobby here.
Okay, sir. So I'll just inform her this.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Now, see, we are dividing here case 1 and case 2 because these are recursive algorithms. The frequency and total steps, we need to calculate it two different times because the execution flow varies depending upon the case values. So we have made two different cases. And for the first case, that is case 1, we just wrote the frequencies, and for the same case 1, we wrote the big O notation. Okay. Is it good, students, so far? Any doubts? Are there any doubts?
No, sir.
Okay, now, coming back to the second case. Coming back to the second case, that is n greater than 1. So when n value is greater than 1, do you think that this if condition gets executed or
no,
not?
No, sir.
Okay, any other answer? Listen carefully. When n, the value of n is greater than 1, do you think that the condition, that is if condition, gets executed or not? You forget about the result, whether it is a true or a false. But does that condition statement gets executed?
Yes, sir.
It will check.
Yes, sir.
It will check the condition, right? Once it checks the condition, then only it will decide what is the result, right? So this particular statement will get executed. So the frequency is again 1. Now, the result is what? Is it true or false?
False.
False. False. False in the sense, does this return 1 gets executed?
No, sir.
No.
Means it is not getting executed. But which is the statement gets executed? The next statement, that is the statement under the else part. Right now, again here, if you look, that this is what recursive call, as I said, it depends upon the depth of the recursive function. Sorry, for the recursive functions or the recursive algorithms, the number of times that particular recursive function calls.
Excuse me, sir, your voice is breaking a lot.
How about others, students? For others, it is breaking, or you are able to hear me?
Able to hear.
We are able to.
So that breaking, means the problem is at your side.
Sir, it's breaking. Sir, it's breaking in between.
Yeah.
No, sir, it's.
Let me try to speak up here. Okay, now, from my end, I have got a good internet connectivity. It is fine. Those who are not able to hear me properly, if it is breaking, then probably at that moment the internet bandwidth is going down on your device. Okay, so that could be the reason. Okay, students, fine. Okay, now the recursive algorithms, these algorithms will be called by the number of times, which is directly depending upon the depth of that particular algorithm. Okay, now how we can find out the depth of a particular algorithm? This is very simple. Pay attention and write. Assume take the value of n equal to 3. Consider the n value as 3. When n value is 3, the factorial function or the algorithm will be called. So for the first time, so this is factorial of. When the factorial of 3 is called, what will happen? It is going to call once again as factorial of 2. When the value of n is 2, then again it is going to call the function or the algorithm one more time with the factorial of 1. When the n value becomes 1, it will no longer go into a factorial. Rather, what will happen? The recursiveness will get terminated there itself. Then it will come in a backward direction and then calculates all its values, right? Now, look into the function calls. How many times this particular factorial function is called now?
Three times.
What is the value of n?
Three.
So in general, can we say that if the factorial, the number is n, then this particular function will be called n times?
Yes, sir.
Yes, right? So in that case, can we call this n as the depth of the function or depth of recursive function? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Right? So in that case, the factorial function is going to be executed for n times. The factorial function call will be executed for n times. Now, did you understood why I wrote n here? because this n is the depth of the factorial recursive algorithm or factorial recursive function. The number of times the factorial function is going to be called for, n times, so the frequency is n here. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now according to this, for case 2, what will be the step count? It is going to be big O of 1. This is nothing because we are not executing that particular step. And how about for this step? It is big O of n. It is big O of n. Okay, now we'll just add it up and we can write it in the down here. Let me try to do that. And then here also, these places, we'll just try to sum it up and then write it here itself. So here it gets executed for 2 times. Executed for 2 times. And here it gets executed for how many times? N plus 1 times the frequency. And here it is going to be what? Big O of 1. And here, big O of n. Is this notation understood till here?
Yes, sir.
When you write in the notebook, what you need to do is that you need to draw a line here, a kind of a columns, right? You need to draw one column here and then one more column over here. Between that, again, make a column. Like a tabular format, you need to present the frequencies and the total steps. This is okay. Now let us try to calculate based upon this exercise. Let us try to first calculate the space complexity and then the time complexity. So first one is space complexity. Now, tell me the number of constants, number of variables here. How many constants, how many variables are there? How many variables are there?
One variable n and 3 constants.
One variable n and 3 constants. Now, since this is a recursive algorithm, again, the variable n value depends upon, again, its depth, right? The n value will keep on changing for n number of times. That is the depth of the algorithm. So in that case, we can say that depth of the recursive, or we can say depth of the recursion is n times, okay? And we have one particular variable, say variable n will be equals to what? It is an integer variable, right? So integer variable requires 2 bytes. And for how many times? For n times. Understand this particular statement? The depth of the recursion is n times. And we have a variable n, which is of the integer data type. So every time it requires 2 bytes, right? So 2 bytes is required for all those n times. So total size of this particular variable is going to be what? 2n bytes. 2n bytes. Understood how we derived at 2n bytes for the variable n?
Yes, sir.
Now we have the constants. How many constants are there?
n equal to 0, n equal to 1.
So we have 0. So let me write it as n equals to 0, that part. Then where else we have
1,
which is part of n equals to 1. Then next, students?
N minus 1.
We have n minus 1, that is, shall I write it as a minus 1 pair in n minus 1?
Return 1.
are there only three or are there any more constants? There is one more constant, that is return one. Return one. Return one means, again in this particular statement, we are returning one constant value. Again, this one is a constant. So we have total four constants, right? Now, since each data type is what, integer, all the above constants are of integer type and each requires 2 bytes. So total is equals to 4 into 2 bytes, that is 8 bytes. So total time complexity, that is total space complexity, S of Fourier equals to 2n plus 8 bytes. Any difficulties here? If you are having any difficulties, doubts, please do ask right now. How we derived at the space complexity as 2n plus 8. Okay, now the next part is time complexity. Now, how are we going to calculate time complexity? Again, it depends upon the cases here, right? When the n value is 0 or n value is 1, then we have a different scenario, because if we want to say in a big O notation, it is going to be a constant function, that is big O of 1. And when the case is 2, that is n is greater than 1, then the big O notation is going to be a big O of n, which is a linear function. So the time complexity for case 1, time complexity, the case 1, wherein the n is equals to 0 or n equals to 1. In that case, the time complexity T of factorial equals to, it is 2, right? You can see here, this is 2. 2 means with respect to the big O notation, it is going to be a big O of 1. It is going to be big O of 1. Whereas for the case 2, wherein n is greater than 1, in that case, the time complexity of factorial is equals to, if you look into this, it is n plus 1. It is n plus 1. So in terms of big O notation, it is going to be big O of n. Understood, students?
Yes, sir.
Please do ask if you have any doubts, because the recursive algorithms are a little tricky. Okay. To understand the recursive algorithms, we need to first identify the case 1 values and case 2 values, right? So based upon this, first we are going to write down the frequencies and total steps for both the cases, right? And then we are going to calculate the space complexity as well as time complexity. The space complexity and time complexity, both of them depends upon the depth of the recursion, right? Depending upon the depth of the recursion, we can calculate the size of the variables. Constants doesn't matter because these are the constants, so directly we can calculate it. Again, the time complexity for case 1 and case 2, we need to write it separately. And for all case 1 scenarios, right? The factorial is going to be a constant value, that is big O of 1 itself. And for when the n value is greater than 1, in that case, it could be linear, it could be exponential, or it could be a logarithmic, or it could be a quadratic, depending upon what type of the statements we are writing in this particular algorithm. Understood, students?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now. I hope you have the Fairbook with you. You have Fairbook with you. I'm going to dictate just one paragraph, write it down, and after that you can write the algorithm. I'm going to dictate one paragraph, write it, and after that you can continue writing this particular exercise. Make the heading space and time complexity for recursive algorithms. Space and time complexity for recursive algorithms. Students, are you writing?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. Calculating time and space complexity. Calculating time and space complexity for recursive algorithms. For recursive algorithms, depends upon depth of the algorithm. Depth of the algorithm. Stop. The recursive algorithms exhibit a special behavior depending upon the value of instance characteristics, instance, instance characteristics that determines the depth of recursive algorithm. Full stop. In such cases, the algorithm doesn't loop into recurrence, or continue to recurrence. Continue to be recurrence. Make it a small change. Continue to be recurrence. Hence, the time complexity of recursive algorithms differ based upon the value of instance characteristics. The value of instance characteristic. Now take a screenshot of this screen the first exercise. Students, make a proper lines, the columns for frequencies and total steps. Again, for the case one and case two. Have you captured the screenshot?
Yes, sir.
Moving on to the next slide. Space complexity. Take down the space complexity. Okay. Now I will move on to the next one, that is time complexity. Take the third screenshot as well. Completed. Now, revise this particular exercise at home and understand once again. Tomorrow we will solve two more exercises based on the recursive method.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any doubts, any questions, students? Okay, then. If there are no, then we will wind up the class here.